Hey, just before we delve into this video, I'd like to say a few short disclaimers. The first one is about how the mic changes throughout. Well, not throughout, but like after 20 minutes into the video or something, approximately around that time. The mic changes from my usual one to this one you're hearing now. It was a spontaneous decision and I made it without thinking of how different they sound. Also, you may or may not have noticed this faint buzzing. Yeah, that's interference, and no matter what I do, it won't go away, and I have tried noise reduction in Audacity, noise gate, it just doesn't want to go away. I do switch to the other mic for editor's notes, but I address that in the video. Secondly, I spoil some things for the pre-made Neighbourhoods and Desiderata Valley, so if you want to go into them blind, well, you can come back to this video another time, after you've experienced them. And yes, this is a long video, so grab your favourite drink and snack, and I hope you enjoy the video. Hello everybody, it is I, CrystalFlame360, or if you prefer, just Crystal, and welcome to this small corner of the internet, what I just do, whatever I feel like doing. In today's video, I'm going to be talking about a small, overlooked neighbourhood by the name of Desiderata Valley. Now, why on earth have I decided to do this? Well, one reason is just because why not? But another reason is I just want to share my thoughts on this neighbourhood. If you watched my opinions video, then you'll know that I expressed nothing but disinterest in the EP hoods and went as far as to say I'd never play them. However, that changed after I recorded my tier list video last year and realised how many Sims I was missing out on for not playing them. Now, this is a slow process since there is nothing particularly gripping about these HUDs, like, at all, as I expressed in my opinions video, but while setting up a new mega HUD using Strange Town as a base and Pleasant View as a shopping district, I felt adventurous and just decided to add Desiderata Valley to the mix. What I've learnt from this is when added to the other HUDs, it shines a lot and the Sims within can get up to all sorts of hijinks, but on its own, it doesn't seem particularly gripping or exciting. This video aims to explore why, as well as talk about how it was done dirty and not allowed to reach its full potential due to laziness on Maxis's end. I feel bad for saying that since they may have been rushed by EA, were burnt out, or maybe it was just a completely different team working on this HUD compared to the first three base game neighbourhoods. Okay, so I should have this on screen. Right, so from what I'm seeing, The Sims 2 was given to a different team, The Sims Studio, after the Pets expansion was released, and they were the developers for the remainder of The Sims 2's lifespan. Most of Maxis left to work on Spore with Will Wright, but from my understanding, some were left behind to work on The Sims 2. Now, my theory is that most of the creatives that made the base game HUD special were working on Spore, so that could be a reason for the decline in the quality of the EP HUDs. But that's just a theory and my thoughts on it, so don't take it as fact, but it seems kind of likely considering how Dead Inside the devs of The Sims 4 seem to be, because let's face it, it's not a good game. And if you want to know why I'm whispering in this section, it's 2012, no, not even 2011, it's 2012, and people are in bed. I'm editing this kind of late to release gathering assets at this point, but yeah, there's no time for behind the scenes stuff. Okay, I'm gonna go. But regardless, it is what it is. Hopefully you enjoy the ride as I ramble about a neighbourhood that not many players, understandably, don't care about. Desiderata Desiderata Valley is the main neighbourhood that shipped with the FreeTime Expansion Pack in 2008. It's described as a serene place that's located in the hills, a wonderful place to relax, and being an overall great place to think about pursuing dreams and aspirations. The FreeTime Expansion Pack introduced hobbies and the hobby system into the game, and Desiderata Valley is basically just a playground to explore these features. As a result, unlike Pleasant View, that is filled with affairs and scandals and is pretty much just a playable version of EastEnders and Coronation Street. Strange Town, a place filled with sci-fi elements, mysteries, aliens, a serial killer, and even the Son of Death, and Veronaville, which focuses on a neighbourhood-wide feud that has gone on for years, being filled with many casualties. Desiderata Valley primarily focuses on the residents' hobbies and leisure activities. There is nothing going on outside of that. There is no overarching story unfolding in the background to keep players engaged, or even making the HUD interesting enough to check out. Compare this to Strange Town, where you've got missing Bella Goth sightings, Pleasant View, affairs and scandals, and let's see what hobbies these Sims have doesn't seem that engaging in comparison. However, the HUD's bio teases the question, who knows what destiny has in store for the Sims of Desiderata Valley, which basically translates to, what new hobbies will they discover? I don't know about you, but I'd rather examine all of Spectre's garden. In Desiderata Valley, there are six families placed in lots. These are the Aspir, Belle, Contrary, Jocque, Mole, and Una families. There are no Sims in the family bin ready to be placed down. Now, FreeTime does come with the Hobby Stealth HUD, which places the Cook and Picasso families in the bin, but they're placed in every neighbourhood provided you haven't disabled or replaced the stealth HUD template with clean ones. So they're not really crucial to Desiderata Valley's story, and as such I won't be discussing them. Unlike the three base game neighbourhoods, there is no specific play order for these households, and in my personal game, I played them based on the order they've interacted with Sims outside of their own neighbourhood. So for example, the Jocques was first in the rotation in my game because Violet was the first to interact with a Strange Town Sim, in this case being Ophelia. Rick made friends with Rip, making the Contrary second in Desiderata Valley's rotation, and you get the gist. For this video, however, I'm just going to talk about the households in alphabetical order. It keeps things simple. The Aspers are a family that can be easily described as the burbs of Desiderata Valley, even down to the dynamic of the two parents. Victor, being a family sim, wants to expand the family, while his wife Elizabeth, being a fortune sim, is happy with just Pauline and wants to focus on her career, understandably. The only surface level difference they have from the burbs is that the daughter is a toddler as opposed to a child, and unlike the Burbs, who just have each other and Lucy, the Aspers live with Victor's dad, Luis, who is now widowed. Luis is a retired architect who primarily focuses on his tinkering hobby in his downtime. He doesn't really have much going on for him, except he's suspicious of John Mole, a guy who his cousin Natasha has been talking to recently, and he has a mysterious lamp to discover in his attic. This serves to introduce one of the new features of FreeTime, which is Sims receiving a genie lamp if the aspiration bar is good enough and they've dedicated enough time to a hobby to gain enough enthusiasm. Or they've gained enough enthusiasm. Whatever. It's implied that Luis would use the lamp. Yes, he would use it. It depends on how he's feeling. It's implied that Luis could use the lamp to resurrect his late wife, but the player can do whatever they wish. No pun intended. Victor, outside of whining for more children, literally has no meat to his character. Sure, if you look through his memories, you'll see that he had a thing with Hannah Bell, best friend of Elizabeth, once upon a time. That's it. He is honestly just a boring run-of-the-mill family guy. Elizabeth is just as blonde as Jennifer Beer but pleasant of you, a career-driven woman with not a lot going on up there. However, unlike Victor, there is a little bit of interest to her character. Looking through the storytelling images, she strikes me as not being particularly happy with being a mother. She appears low energy compared to the rest of her family. Whether this was intentional or Max is just being lazy creating the storytelling images is a mystery, because looking through the storytelling images, I'll get there in a later section. I'll also mention that Elizabeth had a thing with Isaac Bell in her teen years. Another core aspect of Elizabeth's character is her wanting to branch out into a different hobby, which is the overall theme of Desiderata Valley, or at the very least, from what I could glean.
Have you ever looked at the Sims in Desiderata Valley and have been bothered by the fact that the predetermined hobbies don't quite match the hobbies they are supposed to be interested in? Victor Aspir's a hobby.
Is he a hobby?
If Victor Aspir's hobby is supposed to be nature, then why is his predetermined hobby cuisine?
That's the point. The focus of Desiderata Valley's story is the hobbies of the inhabitants, and part of that is having them discover their true calling. Their true hobby. Yes, some of the inhabitants have hobbies starting out that they enjoy, but they've yet to discover a hobby they truly enjoy and excel in. That's why certain Sims' hobbies and predetermined hobbies don't match. Maxes were lazy with this neighbourhood, but I feel that there was a reason for this particular quirk. Tangent over with. Let's go over Pauline. She's a happy toddler, and that is it. Other than her sizable inheritance that she gives to the tree coos. I've not forgotten about that, Pauline. Where'd you get the money from? Because of her age, she has nothing going on. Again, outside of her inheritance. Like, Pauline, where are you storing the cash?
Hey, just editor me dropping in. This is going to be a quick note about Pauline. I'm so good at this. I'm in the middle of editing right now. So, yeah. But no, I'm more collecting assets, but you know what I mean. At this point. At this point, I'll be editing, okay? So I'm coming in to correct myself. Instead of talking about that, I'll just get to the point. So, I've said that Pauline is just a happy toddler and has nothing else going on in her little noggin. Apparently, she does. According to her bio, she's actually quite lonely and is eager to learn and wants to know what life has in store, or something like that. I actually have a wiki page up right now. It just says, you're probably seeing it on screen, Pauline is a happy baby but lonely. She's eager to learn, but she'll have to wait to see what destiny has in store. What destiny is, of course, depends on the player. This has been going on for 1 minute now, so I'll just cut it here. Well, not the video, but just back to the actual video itself. Flipping hell.
The Bells are arguably the most boring family in this neighbourhood. Or at least in my personal opinion. The overview of this family only tells us how happy Hannah and Isaac are, while questioning whether Sharon moving in will cause a critical disturbance. The most common assumption seems to be that this is alluding to a possible affair between Isaac and Sharon, what with Sharon being a romancer and all. But I honestly don't think that's the case. Looking through their storytelling images tells me that this critical disturbance is just tension in the house caused by Isaac and Sharon not getting along with one another, making Hannah conflicted since her sister and spouse don't like each other. In one of the images, it looks like they're arguing. However, looking through their relationship panel shows that they are best friends. So, is this critical disturbance actually an affair, or passive aggression, or fuck knows? Either way, the game is trying to create a false sense of drama for these guys that just isn't there. Another more plausible theory, at least for the storytelling images, is that Isaac and Sharon don't quite get off on the right foot, but they get on nowadays. Isaac is a pretty boring sim. His only conflict is wanting to balance his quest for fame and his family life. As someone in the previous section... The fuck am I like this today? As mentioned in the previous section, he had a thing with Elizabeth Aspir when they were teens, but he and Victor swapped girlfriends and have been happy ever since. Or so we think. He can also begin an affair with Sharon, but we've already been over this. Hannah is Sharon's older sister. I'm not sure if I've actually made that clear, but if I have, well, now you've just heard it twice. Congratulations. Hannah Bell fucking sucks, and yes, I sound aggressive here, but there's really no bite to her character to keep me gripped, and the game doesn't give nudges as to what can be done with her. She's just a family sim who wants babies. Which makes me think, why didn't her and Victor work out again? You'd think her bio would help give you a general idea of what her character is like, but no. All it tells you is that she met Elizabeth Aspir in high school, they have been inseparable ever since, and having a career and family hasn't weakened their bond. Thanks, game! All that's told me is that she has to call Liz regularly, or she'll get clingy. To give her credit, it's apparent that she loves dance and is encouraging her son to follow in her footsteps by nurturing her thirst for creativity, as mentioned in her son's bio. But that still doesn't give me ideas for her. The entire Bell family for me is a family I always play on speed 3. They just suck. Right, so Sharon exists. She's a young woman struggling financially, so has moved in with her sister temporarily until she gets back on her feet. Her bio also mentions her interest in the mysterious John Mole, and she really wants to get to know him, but he's a little aloof. I personally think she's the only interesting sim in this family because, unlike the rest of the household who have nothing interesting going on outside of their immediate surroundings, Sharon does. She can either pursue John Mole or just go screw it and try a slice of Isaac pie. Did that come off as gross? I'm genuinely unsure. It sounded kind of cool in the script, but saying it out loud has a different feel. Don't get me wrong, she's far from being one of my favourite sims, but compared to the rest of her family, she is the one with character, at least in my opinion. Lastly, we have Daniel, a child with artistic abilities. Outside of the game questioning whether Hannah is going to allow him to branch off into other interests outside of art, there's nothing much going on with him. Also, while we're on the topic of Daniel, is it just me or does he look a little creepy when he gets older? It's just how square his chin kind of looks, and that contrasting with how gaunt his face ends up looking. I mean, he looks interesting, he's not boring looking in the slightest, but something just doesn't sit right with me. It's kind of like Matthew Hart, where there's nothing wrong with him per se, but just, he weirds me out.
Now, this could possibly be the only family I will be overly positive about in this video, because in my personal opinion, the Contraries are the only interesting family that has conflict that the gameplay backs up. This family consists of a married couple and their teenage son who's going through some stuff. Because of this, the family are kind of hanging on by a thread, with the bio wondering whether this family will be able to get enough love and understanding to glue them back together, roughly paraphrased. I love this. I'm someone who loves dysfunctional families, and in a neighbourhood that mostly consists of families that have healthy relationships right out of the gate, this is refreshing. To begin going over the individual sims, we have Edward, who I honestly think is the real second curious brother, while Vidkun was just adopted after Eddie went missing, because Edward looks more like Vidkun's brothers than Vidkun does. Anyway, Edward is described as being content with his life and is always striving for self-improvement and knowledge where it can be found. like the Curious Brothers. As you may have guessed, he's a knowledge sim. Like the Curious, okay, you get the gist. I'm gonna stop injecting parallels. I still think he could be a long-lost Curious Brother, though. His bio also mentions that he occasionally helps his close acquaintance, Mr. Mole, with tasks. What these tasks are, though, I'm unsure. But since Edward is an intelligent knowledge sim, and John Mole works in the intelligence courier, I think it'd be safe to assume that it's something to do with that. Maybe he creates gadgets, or helps with investigative stuff. But either way, it's speculative. Opal is a knowledge sim, like her husband, so their compatibility makes sense. Unlike family sim Hannah Bell leaving family sim Victor Aspir for popularity sim Isa Bell, whose priority wouldn't be having a family. Granted, if every sim dated their own aspiration, the game would be boring, so I don't know why I'm criticising. Anyway, onto Opal. Her main conflict revolves around her son and how she wishes he'd do more than just play games, but doesn't bother trying to push him to explore different interests because his current one makes him happy. To me, the last line of her bio, "at least it makes him happy," seems kind of resigned, as if she's trying to suggest different things he could do but is met with resistance. However, that could be me looking too deeply into it. Her and Edward work in the same field, and that's about it. Lastly, we have Rick, who I remember being called bootleg Rip Grun during my tier list video.
Who the fuck are you? I want to say he's called Rick Contrary. I almost called him bootleg Rip Grun because of the hair. Just the bootleg version. I think he is, though, because I think he's also there like, fuck you, Dad.
I still kind of stand by that in some kind of joking way, which may not make sense to you, but it does to me. So Rick, where the fuck to start with this kid? He's currently going through the no one understands me phase of his teen years, and as such, he's moody and would rather play games than interact with his family. Relatable. This translates into gameplay as he hates his parents and considers them to be his enemies, though while his parents share the family flag, and the enemy flag obviously, they don't hate him and just view him as an acquaintance. This seems to imply that his parents care and maybe try to understand him, but he shuts them out. Looking through the storytelling images implies that they got along during his formative years, and it's since he entered his teens that the family dynamic kind of fell apart, shifted in a negative way. I tend to headcanon that with Edward and Opal both being knowledge sims, they had high expectations of Rick and were imparting knowledge to him from a young age, and he was a gifted kid, so that only made the expectations higher. Once he entered his teens, he became stressed with the natural changes of being a teenager and was just depressed overall. But his parents honestly couldn't understand what he was going through, even though they tried, which built resentment and led to arguments. He eventually discovered games as a form of escapism, but isn't all that into it either. It just seems to be used as a crutch. His interest in entertainment is low, meaning TV and video games aren't all that interesting to him. His predetermined hobby is sports, which tells me that it's an undiscovered interest of his, and to drive home that this makes sense for him, he is extremely active, so it's odd that he sits down playing games all day, which kind of fuels my he's depressed theory. His mother shares the same predetermined hobby, so a possible story direction could be that Opal pushes him to play basketball with her, and they both enjoy it and bond, improving their relationship. Rick discovers his true calling in sports, which allows him to burn off energy and maybe improve his outlook on things. Or, if you're like me and you enjoy the family drama, he gets introduced to sports through his BFF Violet, which makes him happier, but he's still bitter and cold towards his parents for not understanding him. So, the drama. This household can get ugly, but only if you use mean interactions to any age by hexagonal by pyramid. Without it, the contraries will behave like a normal family with nothing going on, and due to them not performing mean interactions to one another, they will just patch things up over a few meal times and casual interactions. With the mod, because Rick hates both parents, he will provoke them autonomously, leading to chaos. In my game, he provoked Edward to the point of them getting into a fight, and they never recovered. Opal has a high relationship with Rick, but it's unreciprocated, and Rick still views her negatively. So there's that. To wrap up this section, which has gone on longer than the other family so far, I will share one last headcanon I have. I am going to put a trigger warning here, which may give you an idea what this headcanon is, and if you're interested, or shall I say not interested, or topics like this upset you, I'll put a timestamp on the screen so that you can skip this section, or you can go into the description and skip to the next chapter. It's up to you what you want to do. I'll give you 5 seconds. Alright, so I don't know why or how I jumped to this conclusion, but I headcanon Rick as being a rainbow baby. I interpret Opal to have struggled with infertility, and whenever she would get pregnant, she'd lose the baby through a miscarriage. Now, when she fell pregnant with Rick, she was understandably fearful of losing him, but she didn't. He was almost like a miracle to her, which is why she doesn't push him too hard to try different things and maybe tries to understand him, but just frustrates him more. I will reiterate, this is my personal headcanon, and thus is grounded in theory, not fact, and I still don't know how or why I came to this conclusion, but you know, headcanons be like that. Okay, we've been on this family for too long, so now it's time to move on to a family that is closely related to them, or should I say closely tied. So something you'll notice right out of the gate with this family is that the name literally sounds like Jocque, and you may be pleased to know that they follow through with their namesake. They are a sporty family who value exercise, and as I mentioned previously, they are closely tied to the Contraries because a bit of that drama bleeds into the Jocques a little bit, but not really in a meaningful way, you'll see what I mean shortly. Now, the bio is weirdly ambiguous and doesn't give me much to go off of, which is a common theme with this neighbourhood, unfortunately. It mentions how they have a wonderful family life, which tells me they're a stable family, but then it poses this question that confuses the hell out of me. Can they continue through the stresses to come? What stresses are they referring to? The question following this one, will they find time to relax and enjoy life, gives me the impression that what the game is referring to is the stress of balancing one's work life with their free time. You get it? Sophia's bio supports this assumption, but I'll go more in detail when I begin covering Sophia. For now, we are with Marcel, a man who loves his food, or so you'd think. He works in the culinary industry, he has enthusiasm in cuisine, and his bio even outright says he loves food. But his interest in food is non-existent. Going under the assumption that this isn't just Max's laziness, there could be an in-universe explanation for this, and why, despite making fun of it, I'm not really bothered by it. Words are hard. Marcel's bio mentions that he loves food, but his wife loves a fit man, and ends with the question of whether he's able to keep his love to a minimum so he can keep a slim waist for his wife. Would I be overreacting if I said that I find this problematic? To me, it looks like Marcel has developed an unhealthy relationship with food because of this pressure to stay slim so Sophia is pleased with him. This could be why, despite his love of food, his interest is low. I may be digging too much, but damn, Marcel needs to leave her and find someone better. If someone is with you on the condition you stay a certain weight, it's not good and adds unnecessary pressure that you don't need. Outside of that, there's not much further I can go into unless I'm missing something. Sophia doesn't give me good vibes, even outside of my views on how she's potentially treating poor Marcel. I don't think I mentioned this in the contrary section, but Sophia is really close with Opal. They met as children and became best friends as teens. They're that close that they presumably attended each other's weddings, and their children have grown up with one another since they were children. Toddlers, if you're using Meet Me to the River's Fix templates. Why have I suddenly mentioned Opal? Because she's relevant. Sophia's bio reads as follows. Sophia loves to work out and has a pretty demanding job. Can she and her best friend Opal find time for themselves in their busy schedules? Now, I was going to begin making fun of her by saying that the pair of them are level 2 in their respective careers and only work until 3 o'clock, but that would be ignoring the fact that jobs are demanding in general and that Sophia's line of work is physical, so yeah, glad I reflected before committing to that bit. Instead, I'll mention how she's built off a broken face template that links back to the elf template. So, don't get confused if she suddenly gets pointy ears and looks like she walks straight out of her ownerville when she becomes an elder. Sophia is one of those Sims that I don't exactly find compelling, so outside of her primary concern being her husband's weight and when she can find time with her busy schedule, there's not a lot to tap into. Now, Violet is a sporty girl, and that's made obvious by her bedroom decor and apparel. She's the BFF of Rick Contrary, and she has a broken face. Yeah, that kind of happens when you inherit some features from the parent who was built on a broken face template. Unlike her friend Rick, Violet has a healthy relationship with her family, and even gets on with his parents. Her bio mentions how she wants to help Edward and Opal understand Rick, and help Rick understand Edward and Opal. Love and understanding is a two-way street, Rick. She seems quite sweet based on her bio and how she appears in storytelling images, but she's grouchy with 3 nice points, meaning she'll pick up fights randomly on community lots. Like her dad, or no, not like her dad. Like her dad, although she's supposed to be this massive sports enthusiast, her interest in sports is not there as far as her interests panel goes. How do I excuse this when outside of Max's laziness? I think she's just pretending in some capacity. Her predetermined hobby is fitness, so she is interested in keeping fit, but she doesn't actually enjoy sports all that much. However, her parents could have made her do a lot of sports, extracurricular activities or whatever when she was a child, and she'd go along with it but didn't actually enjoy it. Her parents would then get her a bunch of sports memorabilia as gifts and stuff, and she'd accept them not wanting to be rude. My poise leaves a lot to be desired. She'd rather go for a simple jog than chase a ball around the field. But that's my interpretation based on the information I've been presented. Does it make sense? It does to me. I'm going to close the Jocques off here since I can't think of anything else. The last two families are going to be much shorter to get through because they only consist of one person each. John Mole is a spy who lives in Desiderata Valley, and one of his main pastimes is watching the residents. And as a result, he knows everybody in the neighbourhood. Based on the family bio and his personal bio, his conflict seems to be if he will ever get to live his own life outside of watching people. I guess I solved the mystery of who that one Rockwell song was about. On the surface, he doesn't seem like much, but when you dig deeper, he actually has quite an interesting backstory. I sound sarcastic, but I mean, you kind of have to when talking about this neighbourhood. John comes from a long line of, in the game's words, smart and highly trained intelligence agents who always mysteriously disappear, and that was exactly what happened to his parents. Because of that unfortunate event, he was raised by his grandmother. Now, the timeline isn't exactly clear because of the inconsistencies between the storytelling images and his memories. If we're going off his memories, his parents died when he was a toddler, leaving him in the custody of his grandmother until her passing when he was a teenager. However, if we look in the storytelling images, all that information gets contradicted because there is a picture of John as a child with his parents, and the family photo used for the neighbourhood story shows an adult John with his grandmother. I think the storytelling images tell the true story, while the memories got certain age transitions messed up, because that is a common issue with this neighbourhood, an issue that will be further shown in a later section. To conclude this sad backstory of his, the death of his mother seems to have left an impact on him, and he's still deeply affected. Since when his household is first loaded, John will immediately have a thought bubble of her. Cute, I guess. Now, I think this detail is funny. While it's less of a detail and more of an inconsistency that could be played into his story. Like a few other Sims we've been over, with Marcel and Violet being recent examples, a particular interest of John's doesn't fit in with something that's a major aspect of his life. However, unlike the previously mentioned examples, John's isn't hobby-based but career-based. He has very little interest in crime, but works as a crime scene investigator in the intelligence career. I feel that this career choice might be less him wanting to do it out of enjoyment, and more out of wanting to follow in his family's footsteps and maybe try to get to the bottom of his parents' disappearances. But that's just interpretive. A common theme you'll probably notice at this point. To close off this section, I'll briefly go over his relationships. As mentioned at the start of this section, he knows everyone in the neighbourhood. Except for townies, he has acquaintances with everyone, except for Sharon Worth, Edward Contrary, Hannah Bell, and Marcel Jocque. He has a crush on Sharon Worth, so that means he reciprocates her feelings, and he's friends with Edward, Hannah, and even Marcel. Then we have Louise Aspir, who doesn't like him, and Natasha Una, whose dynamic with him is complicated. I don't know how to open Natasha's section, but I guess you could argue that that is an opener on its own. So Natasha is unique in the sense that she is the only pre-made Sim to have the grilled cheese aspiration, and I honestly think that has her doomed from the start. Grilled cheese Sims don't roll any ones outside of their own aspiration, and all ones associated with the aspiration are for grilled cheese. Sims want to make grilled cheese, serve grilled cheese, eat grilled cheese, talk about grilled cheese and all that jazz. They never roll ones for jobs, commitments, babies, or even skills, unless it's for cooking to improve their grilled cheese making skills. As a result, grilled cheese Sims are miserable unless they do nothing but eat, cook, and talk about grilled cheese. So, if you play purely ones based, yeah, she ain't gonna advance unless you force her. Now, time for a fun display of story and gameplay segregation, which, if you don't know, is where a gameplay mechanic or an aspect of gameplay contradict what the story is trying to get across. An easy example to use would be Dina Caliente from Pleasant View. When you're playing her and leave her to her own devices, she is very friendly and playful, and regardless of whether you go through the whole scripted event with Mortimer, she will roll ones for a job or even a baby, at least from my experience. That's her in gameplay, but how are you supposed to view her story-wise? A scheming gold digger who's trying to marry Mortimer for his money because she doesn't want to work. Yes, the gameplay doesn't half contradict that. That, combined with her memories, make me view her in a more positive light than I feel Max is intended. But this is about Natasha, so how does it affect her? Her bio mentions she's beginning to realise that there is more to life than crafting and the delightful aroma of grilled cheese. But when she's played, she wants to do nothing but eat grilled cheese, cook grilled cheese, you get the gist. So, the gameplay is contradicting the story someone on the development team was trying to tell, however, they could have just underestimated the strength of the aspiration. She has a hidden knowledge aspiration token in her memories, viewable in SimPE, but that does nothing to balance her out, and in my experience, giving her a secondary aspiration in general does nothing. The segregation continues with the rest of her story, so her bio mentions how John Mole can help her find what she is missing, hinting at romantic interest. Not only does she roll no ones for him because of the grilled cheese aspiration, but the pair also have negative chemistry. They're repulsed by each other. Well done, Maxis. You fucked it. As you may have gathered based on me saying that she'll never roll ones for jobs, she is unemployed, but seems to get by from selling her paintings and pottery. That's her redeeming quality and why I don't hate her despite how I come across in general. She's relaxing to play, and having her run a pottery business is actually fun. I also have a soft spot for Sims who possess a lot of nice points, so there's that. Okay, time to dive into her relations, or lack thereof. She only knows John Mole and the Aspir family, being friends with her cousin Louise, her first cousin once removed Victor, and Elizabeth. I don't know what to call her. First cousin once removed in-law? I don't think that's even a thing. This brings me to another unique aspect about Natasha. She is one of two pre-maids that have distant enough family ties that she doesn't recognise them as family. So yes, you can have Victor have an affair with her, but I wouldn't. If you're curious, the other Sim is apparently Betty Goldstein, who looks to be a distant relative of the Roths, mainly Sandra and Xander, but again, I just took a brief glance at that because this video was about Desiderata Valley, not River Blossom Hills, I think they come from. Again, I just took a glance at that. To conclude this section, I'll share an odd quirk in addition to a theory. So if you look through her storytelling images, you'll immediately notice that her skin is much lighter, while her mother has medium skin despite being tanned. Basically, mother and daughter somehow swapped skin colours. The tinfoil hat theory comes in here. Is it just me, or does Katerina Una look more like Natasha than young Natasha does? I think the pair were created, but after a while, the developers thought that Katerina looked better and didn't want to kill her off for the purpose of creating ancestors. So, they swapped them around. The Sim representing child Auntie Natasha went on to become the deceased Katerina, while the Sim representing adult Katerina went on to become Natasha. But that's just a theory. Again. Although I think the only thing that contradicts that is the fact that I think the ancestors get created later and Katerina was created after Natasha. So yeah, just take this theory with a grain of salt, but it could be a possibility. Maybe. It's kind of cool though. Anyway, I'm getting sidetracked. Alright, so this is the part I've been looking forward to the most, naturally. This section is going to be going over both the strange quirks and things that aren't exactly issues, but I find them personally annoying. You should be able to tell the difference between general quirks and what I find annoying, but if not, just keep in mind, I'll be starting with the quirks and then annoyances. Or I'll just put what it is in brackets. Yeah, I'll do that. Starting with for some reason, some Sims have memories that are supposed to represent their transition from baby to toddler. Doesn't really sound like an issue and doesn't really have a negative impact on gameplay. At worst, it makes looking at the timeline of events very difficult. Why? Because the game doesn't give a Sim a growing up memory for the baby to toddler transition. The first transition memory they get through normal gameplay is toddler to child. As a result, if you're looking through the Sims' memories to get an idea of their backstory, they'll seem older than they actually are. Using Rick Contrary as an example, if we go solely by his memories, he would have been potty trained as a child, which isn't possible in normal gameplay, and should actually be an adult, not a teenager. Of course, we know what the idea behind that extra memory was, but it doesn't make sense as far as normal gameplay goes, and makes some Sims seem a life stage older. Another Sim that has this quirk is Natasha Una. She was supposedly potty trained as a child, and should be an elder. More Sims suffer too, like Violet, but either way, this point still stands. Clearly, someone on the development team didn't know how memories worked, which is always a good sign when creating a game, not knowing how the mechanics work. The next quirk is Sims having positive memories of negative events. Opal Contrary is one example of a Sim with this issue, as she has a positive memory of growing up badly. Isaac Bell has this issue too, anyway. Not only is this visible in the shipped Max's version, but also in the fixed templates by Meet Me to the River, because I noticed this in the subhood version I was playing in, so don't panic if you see this, it's just an oversight that can be easily fixed in SimPE. I'll quickly add, before anyone says anything, I downloaded the most up-to-date version from her Tumblr, so playing an outdated version isn't the issue. I'll also say that this doesn't bother me, it doesn't affect gameplay or anything, it's just an observation I made. And while we're on the topic of this, I'll add a funny one. John Mole has a positive memory of being burgled. Whatever floats his boat, I guess. The fixed template remedied that one. It was just Opal that slipped through the cracks from my observation. Still on the topic of John Mole, he has a memory of himself getting an A+. Like, in the third person. It's not, "I got an A+, good for me!" It's,
"Wow, John Mole got an A+, I'm so happy for him."
But you are John Mole. So quirky, he likes being burgled and refers to himself in the third person. Jokes aside, that is a quirk he has, so you could argue that he is quirky, in a literal sense. Anyway, memory chronology not making sense is also a thing. Certain events are weirdly out of order and don't make sense. I'll give a couple examples. Natasha Una is younger than Victor Aspir, with her being 29 days until Elder, and him being 22 days until Elder. This would mean that Victor was born before Natasha, but not according to Lewis's memories, where Natasha was apparently born first since he met her when he was a teen. Or an adult if you count his baby to toddler transition. Yeah. He's a victim too, and so is almost everyone in this neighbourhood, I've realised. Natasha also had 3 age transitions before Victor's birth, so that's a headache to think about. Natasha's memories are also a fucking mess. She met Lewis as a toddler, witnessed Lewis's wedding when she was a teen, and met Victor when she was an adult. So either Lewis didn't introduce his son and cousin to each other until recently, or they fucked it. This one makes me laugh because of how nonsensical it is. Like, I'm saying this as if the other one was not nonsensical, but bear with me. So, as we established in John Mole section, he knows everyone in the neighbourhood, and I mean everyone. One of his friends is Edward Contrary. We know that. But how do you think they met? No one knows, but looking through the memories of John, Edward, and even Rick, I noticed something funny. Apparently, before John met Edward, he met Rick, who was a toddler at that time. In John's memories, Rick was the first of the Contraries he met, and Rick's memory of meeting Mr. Mole is placed before his child age transition memory, making him a toddler. Edward's memory of meeting John is also placed before the memory of Rick's child transition, so Ed's son being a toddler when he was introduced to John is consistent. So, How could John have met a toddler before the parents of said toddler? I don't know, but it introduces a weird age discrepancy when you consider that John was apparently an adult when it happened. When the game starts, John is an adult with 29 days until elder. He's still very young, at the very start of his life stage, which doesn't make sense based on these memories. So, the memories state that after John became an adult, he somehow stumbled across a toddler called Rick Contrary, who introduced him to his parents, and he took a liking to Edward. He has never aged since, apparently, since Rick is a teenager when the game starts and John is at the very start of the adult life stage, when at least he should be nearing elderhood, if the memories are to be believed. This is clearly a result of laziness and or being rushed, because shit like this just ruins the storytelling and world building. It should have been checked. This goes for both examples, any I missed, and this one. Yeah, to wrap up this section, I'll briefly go over Hannah and her inconsistent memories, and I'll try to keep this short. So despite her bio mentioning her meeting Elizabeth in high school, meaning her teen years, obviously, her memories say that they met when they were children. Not only that, but according to her memories, Noriko Aspir died a long time ago, since a bunch of other memories have since stacked on top of it, like her marriage and first woohoo memories. While the Aspers themselves remember her passing recently. This HUD is so polished.
Hey, so Editor Crystal briefly coming in here to quickly or briefly or basically anything that means quick, but knowing me, it take a minute or something, to mention something I missed in terms of memories being strange. And the reason why I felt the need to mention this one is because I found this one hilarious. So if you go through Elizabeth Asper's memories, you know how I mentioned that she has a memory of having had her very first kiss with Isaac Bell? Makes sense, right? But this memory appears before she met him, so she supposedly kissed Isaac Bell and then met him a while later. That makes no flippin' sense, honestly, and I don't know how I missed this one. It basically goes to show how inconsistent this neighbourhood is, because I think I found everything. I go over things again, and then I see something new that doesn't look right, and I'm just like, for fuck's sake! I just want to cover as much as I can, but I've probably missed other things. I don't even know where I'm going to mention this one, maybe in the memory inconsistency section. So if you're here listening to this, I will say thank you for making it this far. Because I think this is going to be one long video. I think it might even be longer than my, like, both of my Treecu videos combined. And I think some of it might just be because I'm covering a bunch, like an entire neighborhood and like the families within, while the Treecus are just like one family in downtown. But yeah, as per my usual, this brief editor's note has gone on for 2 minutes, so back to the video. Fucking idiot.
This might be a short one. So every sim, with the exception of Elizabeth Aspir, have default personalities ripped out of Creator Sim. John Mole is a Cas Pisces, Edward Contrary is a Cas Virgo, Opal Contrary is a Cas Scorpio, Isaac Bell is a Cas Libra, Victor Aspir is a Cas Capricorn, Sharon Worth is a Cas Aries, Marcel Jocque is a Cas Sagittarius, and his daughter Violet is a Cas Gemini. You'll notice that, one, there are sims I haven't mentioned, and two, wait, but those aren't the zodiac signs. John is a Taurus, Edward is a Scorpio, Opal is a Capricorn, Isaac is a Sagittarius, Victor is a Pisces, Sharon is a Gemini, Marcel is an Aquarius, and Violet is a Leo. How are the personalities default signs that they don't have? Two words, mismatched signs. For some reason, a lot of pre-made Sims in general, not just in this neighbourhood, have mismatched zodiac signs, and have the common mismatches are what you've seen here, pretty much. John Mole having the personality of a Pisces while bearing the Taurus zodiac sign, and Marcel Jocque having the personality of a Sagittarius while bearing the Aquarius zodiac sign. I should have the mismatches on screen for you to look at. As for Sims I haven't mentioned, their zodiac signs and personalities aren't unique. Natasha has the exact same as Isaac Bell, Louise has the same as John, which is kind of ironic, and Sophia has the exact same as Sharon. Kind of disappointing, eh? Pauline has the same as her father Victor, and Rick has the same as his mother Opal. These make sense since their personalities from one of their parents, but it's still disappointing that they lack uniqueness in their personalities. Lastly, there are two Sims that are both strange exceptions. Hannah Bell, on the surface, has a unique personality, one that would make her a Taurus. But wait, wouldn't her mismatched sign make her a Cancer? Why is she a Sagittarius? Isn't that for Sims that should be Libras? And yes, because her genetic personality is that of a Maxis Libra, the exact same as her husband. Daniel Bell, her son, is genetically a Maxis Capricorn, while his surface personality has been altered slightly, which is why he's a mismatched Pisces like a lot of Maxis Capricorns. I'm not particularly enthused here because sure, these two are more varied gameplay wise, but genetics wise, they're the same as everyone else. Except Elizabeth, who is the only one who doesn't have a personality ripped from Cass. Out of everyone else, only one Sim has a unique personality. What? Sims have lifetime wants that don't correspond with their aspiration and or don't make sense for them. Now, I have this down as a quirk because I don't find it annoying, and also people don't necessarily have to head for their dream straight away. Most don't even realise what the dreams are until much later on in their life, which is fine. John Mole works as a crime scene investigator in the intelligence career, but has the lifetime want to become a city planner. Again, this isn't bad, it could just imply that his heart isn't really in intelligence, but the funny part is that this LTW doesn't roll for popularity Sims. But never fret, even if John's heart isn't in it anymore, the Aspers are. Both Victor and Elizabeth have LTWs to become head of the SCIA, so they could be a potential agent power couple. Then we have funny instances like Isaac Bell and Sharon Worth seemingly swapping LTWs. Isaac wants to be a world-class ballet dancer, but works in entertainment, while Sharon wants to become a prestidigitator while working in dance. This is one I can see being a mistake because Isaac wants to reach for the stars, and Sharon is shown to love dancing. This quirk pervades the rest of the hood, but I just talked about zodiac signs for too long. Never mind LTWs.
Hey, Editor Crystal interrupting. Again, told you there'd be a lot of loose bits, so why am I interrupting this time? All that talk about LTWs, and I didn't address the elephant in the room. Both Daniel Bell and Pauline Aspir have LTWs, which isn't normal for children and toddlers. Usually, this is an indicator for corruption, though not always, it's blown out of proportion. But either way, in this case, it's completely fine. They'll usually roll new ones depending on their aspirations when they become teenagers. Alright, on with the actually scheduled stuff. This is a record for me.
The this section is going to be extremely short because it's just to say that Isaac's name could be a typo. Why do I think this? Well, his bio spells his name the common way Isaac is spelled, with the one S and two A's, while his name is spelt with two S's and one A. The spelling of Isaac's name is really uncommon, and I mean that when I type the name with that spelling, only Isaac's with the one S and two A spelling was coming up. I did find one with that spelling though, an actor called Isaac Ryan Brown, who I've never heard of, but apparently he's in a Disney sitcom called Raven's Home. I find this a really funny coincidence because Isaac Bell wants to be a famous entertainer, and the only person I could find that shares the same spelling as him is a famous entertainer. Technically actor, but actors entertain, so he's an entertainer. But now you're wondering, is it a coincidence? Could Maxis have named him after this actor? No, because the actor was born in 2005, making him around 3 years old when FreeTime came out, so it's a really neat coincidence. In my personal opinion, the storytelling images are awful, especially when compared to the images from the base game Neighbourhoods. The images of Pleasant View, Strange Town, and Veronaville tell a story clearly. The Sims are performing actions that get across what is going on, everyone is at least doing something, and different camera angles and distances are played with that add variety to the images. They are creative and dynamic. The images of Desiderata Valley are, for lack of a better word, shit. Now, there are some exceptions, like I think most of the Contrary's photo album is decent, with the exception of one image. Like, I have a lot of questions. Why are the walls bare? This is clearly Rick's room, what with the bed giving it away? And the walls have nothing on them, almost like they didn't finish decorating the house before taking the images. Now, don't get me started on how zoomed in it is, and Opal just staring at Rick vacantly with her arms at her sides. It's an example of a common theme with these images. There are a lot of Sims just stood there, not doing anything. However, I'm not that mad at these because the rest of the images are fine and clearly tell a story. They were happy to have a baby who was clearly planned. That sounded so sarcastic. They had a good relationship in his formative years. Then he became distant in his teen years and turned to playing games, and Opal is feeling something, I just. Edward then meets John Mole and begins to do things for him. It all makes sense, but I can't say the rest for the other families, with the Aspers being the worst personally. Like, there's an image where the whole family are literally just stood there doing nothing, like what is this supposed to tell me? Then there's another image where, again, they're stood doing nothing. Well, Luis is playing the piano and Victor is cheering, but that's still not captivating enough, and why is this happening? There's even a plumb bob above Noriko's head, like what the fuck is this? The other three images are fine. Elizabeth feeding Pauline, Luis and Victor working on the car, and Elizabeth sewing while Pauline is playing with the activity table. However, only the latter tells me something. Elizabeth makes time for her hobby while caring for Pauline. Now, I'm not going to go in depth for everyone because a lot of it will just be me not thinking of much to say, because the rest of them, except for Una and maybe Mole, suck. Instead, I'm just going to talk about how unpolished a lot of them are, so just assume from this point onward if I don't bring the image up, it's fine. So the Bells only really have one image that grinds my gears, but I'll go more into that in a minute. For the meantime, I'll talk about two images from the Jocque album that just make me think, why was it done like that? The first one is where Marcel and Sophia are stood outside of the house. The angle looks kind of awkward to me, but that couldn't be avoided because Marcel's food thought bubble had to be in the frame for storytelling purposes. What didn't need to be in the frame that the image could have done without is the plumb bob above Sophia's head. There's no excuse for this, since there is a cheat that was introduced in Open for Business to remove it, Plumbob Toggle Off. Now, they may have been taking these in a free time only game, ignoring the H&M outfit Opals has in one image, and if the cheat wasn't there, fair enough, but I'm guessing Violet is somewhere off screen, so they could have easily made her selectable to get the Plumbob away from Sophia. Another issue is Sophia is just standing there vacantly with her arms at her sides. What is this supposed to tell me? At least have her folding her arms to have her do something. It's just so weird. The other image has a similar theme, the one where Violet is conversing with Edward and Opal about the weather, while Rick is vacantly stood off to the side with his arms at his side. Doing nothing. This image gives me second-hand embarrassment, and it sounds hyperbolic and dramatic, but I'm being serious. Who took this and thought it looked good? Imagine being Violet, being a polite guest, and conversing with people that could be your honorary aunt and uncle. But you have your friend, just stood there with a blank expression, probably thinking about the one time he walked in on his parents playing Twister. Rick needs to be doing something to make the image feel alive and less awkward. Anything. Even something as small as him folding his arms with a scowl by the door would be better than this. Or him hastily taking his plate into the kitchen after a meal, like, come on! And did you think I wasn't going to talk about the neighbourhood story images? Well, they are also terrible. The ones that came with the base game had so much effort put in. There was so much personality in them, and they tell you so much about the characters and their storylines, and the devs even went the extra mile to do some photo editing, like, they're bloody brilliant. The ones in DV, typical snapshots that can be easily made with the C key, and a lot of them are lazily done. The Aspers features Victor snuggling Pauline, which is cute, but then you have Elizabeth walking somewhere, and Louis stood there with his arms at his sides, with a dead smile, like he looks dead inside. I don't know why I take issue with it might be because it visually looks boring to me, but it might just be a me thing. Anyway, the main thing to consider is, does it tell us what is going on with the family? Nope, not at all. All that it tells me is that Victor loves his daughter. It doesn't tell me about Louise's attic mystery, or Victor wanting another child while Elizabeth doesn't. Onto the bells. Take this in for a sec. So, the image is Sharon getting out of a taxi, while her family are welcoming her. Not only is the shot too far away, but there's a freaking Plumbob in the frame. Now, I know that even the base game HUD images had some Plumbobs in them, like the Monty one I used earlier, but I can overlook that because of the interesting use of angles and interesting stuff happening in them. And also, there is no such thing as Plumbob toggle on off during the base game. But this is a distant shot of Sharon leaving a taxi, like, why is this the family snapshot image used? All that it says is that Sharon is moving in, which is fine, but it doesn't tell us about the tension building or why she's moving in. The contraries actually have a nice picture, it's actually adorable, two parents happy with their new bundle of joy. However, does it tell us about the family's current situation? No, it doesn't. Opal had to change her wardrobe, so having H&M stuff wasn't a prerequisite to buying free time, and that baby's now a teenager who is miserable. The parents are at their wits' end, and this image doesn't convey that. Frankly, it just looks like they needed an image, so just picked a random one and went, fuck it. So, we're back to the terrible ones again. The Jocque's image features Rick, who has a Plumbob above his head. Again, they could have disabled it with a cheat, or by having Edward or Marcel selectable instead, since they are not featured. Gossiping about Opal to Violet while Sophia is talking animatedly to Opal, who is vacantly watching her son. A common theme with Opal in a lot of these images, apparently. Plumbob aside, what does this tell us about the Jocques? Fuck all, Marcel isn't even featured in the picture, and it's his family. This image tells us that Rick slags off his mum to Violet, Sophia looks bothered about it, and Opal doesn't care. What does this have to do with the whole story of the Jocques? Where's Marcel with his weight gain conflict? Where's Sophia's lack of balance between work and leisure? It's not here. Hell, even the entire family's conflict of stress isn't mentioned. It's just, Rick likes to gossip for a neighbourhood story image for a family that isn't his. Then there's John Mole. His bio was a short, he watches people. Can he get a life? And the image isn't terrible at all, it just doesn't convey that. But hey, at least John is featured in his own storytelling image. Eh, Marcel? Lastly, Natasha's picture is fine. A family dinner with her family that consists of grilled cheese, Natasha's obsession. At least that's established through visuals. I'll say this one is good overall. But surely now you see my point that these aren't good and are poorly done. If you like them, that's fine, but let me know in the comments how you interpret them. That could be an interesting discussion. It also lets me know what you've gotten this far into this video, because this is freaking long and and it's about a neighbourhood that I don't think a lot of people care about. It's like, if you've gotten this far, thank you, appreciate it, glad I've entertained you enough, I suppose. I'm getting sidetracked again. Okay, so time for an interesting quirk to break off the unintended rants directed at storytelling images and the like. Social bunnies. Everyone has heard of them and seen them, but for those unfamiliar, social bunnies are NPCs who only appear when a Sim's social motive has hit an all-time low. They come in three colours, pink, blue and yellow, and can only be seen by the lonely Sim. Think of it more as a Sim being so lonely they imagine a person dressed in a bunny costume, hopping after them and desperately wanting their attention. Now, social bunnies are pre-created for every neighbourhood and are stored with the rest of the NPCs, ready to spawn whenever a Sim gets lonely. There are two exceptions, Desiderata Valley and Belladonna Cove. For some reason, Desiderata Valley and Belladonna Cove technically have no social bunnies and as a result will spawn new ones when they're needed. Now you may have noticed my use of the words technically and spawn new ones, and that's because both neighbourhoods do have social bunnies, they are just not properly binned. They can only be found in the game files via SimPE and don't appear in game because they are in the default family and need to be moved into the NPC bin, which is family instance 0x7FFF. Only after that is done will they appear. They don't appear to have anything wrong with them, they have the usual social bunny tuning in their character file, in addition to the other stuff that's needed for them to appear and function correctly. There are also bitmap images of what looks to be Bud the Repo Man from The Sims 1 in here, though that seems to be a standard for all social bunnies, much in the same way maids all have bitmap images of Bridget the Maid in their character files. However, Desiderata Valley's case is a little more bizarre. The social bunnies in this hood appear like a normal Sim in their thumbnails, which is odd but nothing to really worry about, as they'll appear in the iconic costume when they're needed and their thumbnails will update accordingly. The houses, mainly the unoccupied ones, are beyond terrible. I'm no builder, I'm not very good at it, though I try sometimes, and even I know the buildings look sad. Most of the floor plans are wide open areas downstairs and smaller rooms upstairs, with massive roofs and the houses themselves being small despite the area around them being large in some cases. That's all I've got to say on the houses because building isn't exactly my forte, but I will close the section off by saying that the state of the occupied lots seem to be divisive from what I've noticed, and this extends to the community lots. I've seen some say that the lots the Sims live in and the community lots are one of the redeeming factors. None of. one of the redeeming factors of the neighbourhood, while I've seen many others say that they are terrible. I think they're fine personally, but this is coming from a non-builder, so yeah. Those were the only quirks I noticed and could find. If I missed any, feel free to let me know and maybe I could address it or something.
This is a last minute addition. Again, when you think you found everything, another something comes up. So in this mini section, I'm going to mention two potential lore pieces I missed and a quirk that I'm surprised I missed, honestly, considering this popped up frequently when I was going through my constantly looking at glitchy Sims obsession. I still do that every so often, but yeah, that's not the point. So the first bit of lore is the Worths, Hannah and Sharon's parents, were abducted by aliens. It's a neat detail, but it's not something that influences the sisters' story, so it's inconsequential for the most part. And another neat thing too is that what also supports this and makes it less likely to be an error on the creator's part is that there is a crashed UFO somewhere on the map. I might have it on screen. I don't know, because at this point I'm like mid through editing, so I've already collected all the assets I need. So I don't know. I don't know how I'm going to show this information at this point. But again, cool detail. The next is Elizabeth having been involved in a fire. Again, it's an interesting detail, but what does it add? Nothing. It's just like, oh, she's been involved in a fire. How does it affect her? Nothing, just has a negative memory, that's all. And there's now time for the quirk. I don't think that made sense, but whatever. So John Mole's mother, Lucy, has an ambiguous gender. What this means is something happened to her resulting in the partial wiping of her data, so she was reverted to the seemingly default state of a sim, which is an adult male. Even though she appears female, the game treats her like a male. Despite this, I'm sure she's safe to resurrect, but that's up to you if you want to take the risk. I mean, all that's wrong with her is the ambiguous gender, I'm pretty sure. I don't think I don't know, I might have it on screen. And that's all I wanted to add. I still feel I may have missed a bunch of things, but that's just a testament to how poorly this neighbourhood was put together. I think that was my first I feel proud of myself. I think what helps is that I have notes in front of me of what I was going to say for this editor's note section. I will quickly apologise before jumping into the next section about the jumping mic changes, because I'm sure you've noticed it by now. Like the first maybe 20 something of that video use this mic, and then like from the contrary section onwards is like a different mic, and then you've got this mic piping in random intervals going, hey, editor me here, you're like, what the fuck is this? Just in case, like, it's bothering some people, because I know it can. But like, this is the mic that's usually like close by, and it's just always there, so like when I'm editing, I'm like, oh, I gotta add something, just whip it out. But yeah, hopefully this video is still watchable regardless, and this section has almost gone on for 4 minutes, which is the longest crystal ramble section, so with that all said and done, let's continue to the next section before the next 5 minutes just becomes me talking. Yeah.
So after all that, going over the Sims and the bizarre happenings with the HUD that highlight its lack of polish, it's now time to delve into the age-old question. Why does nobody like Desiderata Valley? Understandably, most players, myself included, take issue with the lack of overarching story outside of hobbies. There's no disappearance putting people on edge, no criminals in town for John Mole to potentially investigate, no cults pulling strings, and other potential plot threads to inject intrigue into the neighbourhood and get players hooked. I get that its purpose is to show off the hobbies and free time features, but on its own it's bland. There's a reason why the base game HUDs are widely talked about while Desiderata Valley falls into obscurity. For those who aren't aware, the three base game neighbourhoods came with scripted events that served to set up a family story. These are put in effect as soon as you load a family, however they are optional and can be easily ignored if you wish. They'll typically come in the form of prompts and will have scripts that affect certain outcomes. For example, in the Pleasant household from Pleasant View, Daniel is having an affair with Kaylin, the maid, and upon loading the lot, you get a notification making you aware of this. Mary Sue goes to work, the twins go to school, and Kaylin arrives and does her job. Soon enough, she is done and asks Daniel to hang out. You know what to do. As they're about to get down to business, a chance card for Mary Sue comes up, and regardless of the choice you make, she will be sent home, so she can catch Daniel cheating. It's just the circumstances that differ, demotion or termination. More examples include the Calientes always being burgled on the first night you play them, Tank crashing Johnny's party, Vidkun getting abducted by aliens, Dustin getting lectured by Brandy, bringing Angela home from school and getting a phone call from her offering to sneak out, Julia always bringing Tibble over with her, and hopefully you get the gist. Desiderata Valley has none of this, you load up a family and nothing. There's no setup, no idea where to take the families, nothing. There are not even preset ones to give you an idea about what Sim is thinking and where to take them narratively. In Pleasant View, Don has wants pertaining to his conquests. Cassandra wants to get married to Don. Dina wants to get engaged to Mortimer. Mortimer wants to flirt with Nina. What? In Strange Town, Tank wants to join the military career and win a fight against Johnny. Johnny wants to throw a great party and irritate Tank. Olive wants to retire. Vidkund wants to be abducted by aliens. Cersei wants to be promoted, and you get the gist. And as to not leave Verona out, Juliet wants to go steady with Romeo. Puck wants his very first kiss with Hermia. Consort wants to retire. In short, the game informs you that what the Sims want and where the stories can go. The Sims of Desiderata Valley have generic wants tied to their aspirations, nothing that has story potential. For example, both Hannah and Victor have wants for a baby and to gain cooking and cleaning skill points, as well as to play with their kid. Identical wants. Isaac wants to party and buy a bar, both typical popularity Sim wants. Sharon has generic woohoo and flirt ones, typical romance Sim ones. Both Opal and Edward want Rick to be an overachiever and to buy a telescope, typical knowledge Sim ones. Rick wants to earn money, get into private school and earn a talent badge, typical teen fortune Sim wants. You probably get the gist by now. None of their wants are specific to their perceived narrative. Victor should have a baby one in addition to ones related to teaching Pauline her toddler skills. Isaac should have skill ones related to his career progression. Sharon should have romance ones targeted specifically towards John Mole. Rick, the supposed game addict, should at least have the want to play computer games in his wants panel. Maybe in addition to wants like talk to Violet and have fears like run away from home, as opposed to repo man and get rejected from private school, because those sure sound relevant to his story. But yeah, you get the point. So another issue is that it isn't exactly important to the continuity and isn't tied to anything, so we, as the player, don't know where in the timeline this neighbourhood's events, or lack thereof, occur and what relevance this has to the overall Sims timeline and lore. For those wanting concrete answers, it'd be safe to assume that it takes place the same time as Pleasant View and other neighbourhoods, and its importance to the overall lore is nout. Nothing. Zilch. Nada. Nobody cares. Now, Desiderata Valley isn't the only neighbourhood that suffers from this indifference, but any neighbourhood that isn't Pleasant View or Strange Town, my personal favourite, I call myself Strange Town trash for a reason, suffer from it too. Yes, even base game neighbourhood Veronaville, and the reason is simple. The events in these neighbourhoods are inconsequential to the rest of the lore. Pleasant View and Strange Town are tied together, mainly through the Bella Goth mystery. Bella Goth, who originally lived in Pleasant View, was abducted by aliens and placed in Strange Town. In addition, these hoods get expanded on in the spin-offs, like The Sims 2 for the console, and Strange Town was massively expanded on in the DS, GBA, and PSP ports. The rest of the neighbourhoods never got that treatment, and they take place in their own bubble, giving players no reason to care. And, as mentioned, Veronaville isn't even safe from this. There is a reason that despite its iconic status, both for being a base game hood and for its creativity and drama, it isn't talked about much outside of The Sims 2, and why out of the three base game hoods, it's the least liked. The events don't matter outside of its own hood, and that added with no spin-off games getting made about it, it allows it to fade more into obscurity. As you'd have gathered by now, the neighbourhood lacks polish and appears to have been put together with plain paper, glue, and duct tape. Keep in mind, this neighbourhood shipped with the second to last expansion pack near the very end of The Sims 2's lifespan. The base game HUDs shipped pre-corrupt, everyone knows it, it's the first thing people will say if you mention wanting to play them, but at least they had heart and the devs knew what their tools actually did, like the memories. The builds are lazy, as mentioned, and most of the families feel like they came straight from Cass. Turns out they didn't, because I checked, they have one histories. And to make things more confusing, apparently Rick Contrary had 6 A-drops, 3 good and 3 bad. This HUD is so polished. The Sims from the base game HUDs at least felt like they'd been played for a bit and had been created with love. Based on The Sims 2 pre-release blogs and the like, you could tell that Maxes were excited to show them off. In comparison, Desiderata Valley is like the problem child that they want to hide and keep under the stairs. This title made no sense, but hear me out. What I mean is that the backstories lack spice or don't exist at all. In Veronaville, parents were murdered, and in Strange Town, altars were left and murders were had. The only thing close we have to that is John Mole, where his parents mysteriously disappeared when he was little and he could potentially suffer the same fate in his line of work. That's it. Desiderata Valley was doomed from the start. The devs clearly went into it with the intention to build a neighbourhood centred on hobbies and not about the Sims themselves, which was a major mistake. There's a rough saying that what makes a story is its characters, and if the characters aren't good, people skip the story, and it holds water here. The Sims within the neighbourhood are just tools for you to try out the hobby stuff, not full characters, and it's sad. Not only that, but it was clearly rushed and haphazardly put together. No love went into it, they just wanted a HUD and made and out the door. There are so many inconsistencies and odd things that could have easily been found if the devs cared, but clearly they didn't. That or EA rushed them, which again, we know EA do this shit. How we look at the HUD reflects that. We can see how little care went into its development, and there's no reason to play it on its own. This HUD is ideal for mega HUDs due to its small size, and a lot of the issues based on lack of overarching story beats get solved. In my mega HUD, John Moe was investigating the Beakers, Sharon Worth wooed a general Buzz Grunt, Violet and Rick befriended Johnny Rip and Ophelia, Edward got abducted by aliens and killed by Nervous, and you get the point. The Sims shine when given a chance, but as standalone, no. So, in conclusion, I'd say give Desiderata Valley a chance. but only as part of a megahood, or hell, even an uberhood if you're ambitious. It's boring on its own, but the reason is indifference on the dev's part. And that was all she wrote. Wow, this video was long. I bet if you've made it this far, you're like, Crystal, have you seriously made an over an hour long video on Desiderata Valley? And yes, I did. In concept, I thought it was going to be short. It wasn't. This was the deep dive I teased in my last video, if you want to call it a deep dive, but yeah. It was really fun to work on, and I left it feeling so disheartened because this hood does have a lot of missed potential, but was done dirty by its own creators, and they should have known hobbies alone wasn't going to capture players' interest. But anyway, I began working on this video in early September and finished it on the 30th of October, ready to go up today, Friday the 4th of November. Or at least I hope it's ready to go up at that time, because I would have made myself look like a right idiot. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed the video as much as I did making it. I mean, most of my nights were spent making this, and the only thing I sacrificed was my sleep schedule and time I could have spent playing The Sims or making other, like, I wouldn't say easy content per se, but I'm gonna say, like, you know what I mean, like the Plague Town stuff, or I mean, starting up a Strangely Pleasant View again. I don't even know when I'm going to start that up again, but you know. I even went out of my comfort zone, and hopefully that showed, you know. And like, I'm pretty sure the presentation would have seemed a bit different compared to my Treecu video. At least I hope, that was the aim I was going for. But yes, this video is already long as it is. You don't need me rambling at the end here to make it longer. And so I'll say, if you enjoyed the video, you can leave it a like, and if you have anything to say, then feel free to comment. If you're curious or interested to see what I decide to do in the future, then you can also subscribe. It isn't compulsory, it just makes things a little more convenient if you wish to see my future videos appear in your subscription feed instead of your recommendations. And with that, I will say one more thing. I think I do have like one vocal blooper, if you will, and a couple of in-game bloopers after this section, so you can stick around for those three things. I didn't know where else to put them, and they're in the flow more than my beep thing I do. You know, I think you know what I mean. And yeah, on that note, I think I'll also quickly say apologies for, I mean, if you wanted something like a serious kind of like, you know, straight-faced, and this is the Aspir family, you know what I mean, not like the weird comical spin I put on it. I mean, I don't know about any other creators that talked about this neighbourhood, which was why I thought, yeah, why not? It's something I've not seen, so I just thought I'd do it. I don't know, maybe I'm just like an absolute blind idiot and didn't go hunting enough, but you know. But yeah, sorry if this was more than a comical take than you wanted. But yeah, with all that said and done, thank you for watching, and I hope to see you again next time. Bye-bye! They are a sporty family who value exercise, and as I mentioned previously, fuck. Thank you.
Oh,